In biology, molting is the manner in which an animal routinely casts off a part of its body, often but not always, an outer layer or covering, either at specific times of the year or at specific points in its life cycle. Molting is known by many terminologies. Molting in British English, molting in American English, also known as sloughing, shedding, or in many invertebrates, ecdysis. Molting can involve shedding the epidermis or outer skin, pelage, hair, feathers, fur or wool, and other external layers. In some groups, other body parts may be shed, for example, wings in some insects. In arthropods such as insects, arachnids and crustaceans, molting is the shedding of the exoskeleton, which is often called its shell, typically to let the organism grow. Definition: ecdysis comes from the Greek word ekdousis, which means put off. It is defined as the shedding of an outer integument or layer of skin by insects, crustaceans and snakes. It is also called molting. Significance of molting: it is commonly considered that ecdysis is necessary because the exoskeleton is rigid and cannot grow like skin. But this is simplistic, ignoring the fact that most arthropoda with soft, flexible skins also undergo ecdysis. Among other things, ecdysis permits metamorphosis, the sometimes radical difference between the morphology of successive instars and the fact that a new skin can replace structures such as by providing new external lenses for eyes. The new exoskeleton is initially soft but hardens after the molting of the old exoskeleton. The old exoskeleton is called an exuviae. While molting, insects cannot breathe. Ecdysis allows damaged tissue and missing limbs to be regenerated or substantially reformed. Complete regeneration may require a series of molts, the stump becoming a little larger with each molt until it is a normal or near normal. Process of molting: the following steps in this process have been observed. The process begins when epidermal cells start to divide, increasing in number, become closely packed and columnar in form. The next step is apolysis, where the old cuticle breaks away from the epidermal cells, forming a subcuticular space beneath the old cuticle. Enzymes are secreted in the space below the cuticle and begin to digest it. The epidermal cells begin to secrete the new cuticle. The molting fluid contains inactive enzymes at first, which allows for the proper laying down of the new epicuticle. This is the first formed layer and protects the new cuticle as it is being formed. Molting fluid is inactive at first, so it doesn't degrade the new epicuticle that is being made at that time. After epicuticle formation, the molting fluid becomes active and starts to digest the old cuticle. However, only the unsclerotized cuticle can be digested. That is, only the endocuticle is digested with a lot of the product of digestion absorbed back into the epidermal cells. The epidermal cells apparently continue to absorb the digested old cuticle and use this material in adding to the new cuticle. Up to 85% of the old cuticle may be digested. When the new cuticle is otherwise completed, certain enlarged dermal glands discharge their contents over the outside of the new cuticle. This secretion forms the final waxy layer of the epicuticle. When the new cuticle is fully formed, the insect has to break out of the old one. The initial rupture is made along a median line of weak cuticle, which typically extends along the dorsum of the thorax. This rupture is caused by the pressure of the blood. The insect contracts the abdomen, forcing the blood into the thorax and causing it to bulge until the cuticle breaks along the line of weakness. The insect may swallow air or water, if aquatic, to aid in this process. The insect then wriggles and squirms free from the old skin. At or before this time, the molting fluid is usually reabsorbed by the body so that at the time of molting, the area between the old and the new skins may be dry. For a short period after molting, the new cuticle can be stretched, at least in the non-sclerotized membranous portions. During this short period, therefore, the insect stretches the cuticle to accommodate expected increase of the body before the next molt. This is done first by swallowing air or water to increase the internal volume and then by increasing the blood pressure in first one region and then another, thus blowing up the regions and stretching the integument. When the blood pressure is reduced, the stretched integument does not shrink again but contracts into a series of small folds or minute accordion like pleats. In larvae with no sclerotized body areas, these folds may occur over the entire body. In insects with definite sclerotized plates, the folds occur in the membrane between the sclerites. As the body increases in with subsequent growth, the integument increases by a simple expansion of the folds. When this avenue for increase is exhausted, the insect must molt again to allow further increase. The entire active molting process may take only a few seconds or it may require an hour or more. Now, the exocuticle can become hard due to quinone tanning and sclerotization. After its complete formation, the new skin becomes impermeable to many substances, especially water, and is locally sclerotized and colored to assume its normal condition. In many groups, such as the grasshoppers, this occurs just after the stretching process which follows molting. In other cases, for instance, in adult Trichoptera, Lepidoptera and many Hymenoptera, this occurs before molting while the adult is still encased in the pupal skin. It was thought formerly that hardening and coloring of the skin was a result of its exposure to air after molting. But experiments on partial dissection have shown this not to be true. Stages in molting. In stars, each stage of development between molts for insects in the taxon Endopterygota is called an instar or stadium, and each stage between molts of insects in the Exopterygota is called a nymph. There may be up to 15 nymphal stages. Endopterygota tends to have only 4 to 5 instars. Endopterygotes have more alternatives to molting, such as expansion of the cuticle and collapse of air sacs to allow growth of the internal organs. Premolt or proecdysis. Premolt or proecdysis stage occurs just prior to exuviation and is characterized by separation of the old exoskeleton from the underlying epidermal layer. The old exoskeleton is partly reabsorbed and energy reserves are mobilized from the midgut gland. Premolt begins with an increase in concentration of molting hormone in the hemolymph. The first indication that the prion is entering proecdysis is the withdrawal of the epidermis from the old cuticle or apolysis. Later, the epidermis starts to hypertrophy and cells which appear to have storage function accumulate in it. As the prion proceeds through this stage, the epidermis starts to secrete a new epicuticle and exocuticle. Feeding starts to decline and has completely ceased by the end of proecdysis. Thus, reserves need to be available for cuticle synthesis and for the period when feeding ceases. The material for cuticle synthesis are derived from two sources: accumulated reserves due to feeding and resorption from the old cuticle. Ecdysis. Ecdysis as a stage only lasts a few minutes. It begins with the old exoskeleton opening at the dorsal junction of the thorax and abdomen in a decapod, crustaceans, and is completed when the animal escapes from its confines. Post-molt or post-ecdysis. Post-molt is the stage just following exuviation or shedding of the old exoskeleton. It is the period when the exoskeleton expands due to the increased hemolymph volume from the water influx. Water influx occurs across through the epidermis, gills, and gut. After several hours or days, depending upon the total length of the molt cycle, the new exoskeleton hardens and retains its rigidity. Immediately after ecdysis, the only layers present are the epicuticle and exocuticle. Within a few hours of epidermis, starts to secrete the endocuticle. Most of the cuticle must be derived from materials stored in the epidermis, as feeding does not begin until the insect is well into the intermolt stage. Intermolt. During intermolt, the exoskeleton becomes much harder through mineral and protein deposition. Shrimp exoskeleton is relatively thin and soft compared to crabs and lobsters. The volume as well as the weight of the whole prawn increases by 3 to 4% during the intermolt period. This increase may be due to the extension of the thin intersegmental connections of the abdomen and supports the concept that growth in penoids is a more continuous process than in the heavily armored decapods which molt relatively infrequently. Hormonal control of molting. Factors that are involved in the regulating molting include environmental factors such as temperature, photoperiod, humidity, and physiological factors such as quantity and quality of food, presence or absence of nutrients in the food, and infection by microorganisms or parasitoids. Variation in these parameters can accelerate or delay the onset of molting or metamorphosis in complex ways that indirectly or directly stimulate the neuroendocrine system to start the molting process. The two main metamorphic hormones found in the insects are ecdysteroids and juvenile hormones. Ecdysteroids are the molting hormones of insects that will initiate the molting process. The presence or absence of juvenile hormone will determine what type of cuticle the next molt will produce. In the presence of juvenile hormone, the next cuticle will be another immature. In the absence of the juvenile hormone, the insect will develop into an adult. The steroid hormone, ecdysone, is produced by an endocrine gland called the prothoracic gland found in the prothoracic segment of the thorax. It is released hours to days before the actual ecdysis to initiate the molting process. Ecdysone is produced and released from the prothoracic glands into the hemolymph. However, the active hormone is called 20-hydroxyecdysone, which is produced when ecdysone is acted on by the fat body and other tissues. The active hydroxyecdysone will program the epidermal cells to start the molting process. Ecdysone is released into the hemolymph from hours to days after stimulation by PTTH, depending upon the insect. Ecdysteroids are primarily acting on the epidermal cells to produce the changes necessary for a molt to occur, but is really acting on all of the tissues in the insects during the molting process. In hemimetabolous insects, ecdysone is released prior to every molt. In holometabolous insects, the larval to larval molt has one peak of ecdysone before each ecdysis. However, in the last larval instar before the pupal molt, two peaks of ecdysone occurs. It is thought that the first peak is required to switch the state of commitment to produce pupal characteristics. This peak occurs in the absence of juvenile hormone. The second peak of ecdysone usually involves an increased amount of ecdysone and induces the actual molting process that produces the pupae. Ecdysteroid titer is critical for the various phases of molting to occur, and along with the presence or absence of juvenile hormone, determine the type of cuticle the insects will secrete. Juvenile hormone, JH, is produced by the corpora alata, CA. The corpora alata are small endocrine glands associated with the brain. Juvenile hormone is not stored in the corpora alata, and so its biosynthesis is regulated. Insects differ widely in the mechanism by which they control their corpora alata. It is known that the median neurosecretory cells of the brain will produce peptides that control CA. These are called allatostatins and allatotropins. Allatotropins stimulate juvenile hormone and allatostatins inhibit the synthesis of juvenile hormones in the CA. Once JH is biosynthesized, it is not stored in the CA but released into the hemolymph. The amount of juvenile hormone in the hemolymph is also regulated. Since juvenile hormone is a lipophilic compound, it can be bound to various proteins and hemocytes in a non-specific way and also in fats in general. It is also found bound to proteins that will only bind juvenile hormone in a specific way. These JHBPs are important in regulating the levels of juvenile hormone in the hemolymph. The two enzymes that are involved in degradation of juvenile hormone are juvenile hormone esterase and juvenile hormone epoxide hydrolase. These are also produced by the fat body. Juvenile hormone esterase is a specific esterase for juvenile hormone whose role it is to clear the hemolymph of all juvenile hormone in the preparation for the pupal or adult mold. Juvenile hormone esterase level rise at the end of the last larval instar of holometabolous insect at the time when juvenile hormone amounts decline in the hemolymph. This occurs at the same time when the juvenile hormone produced by the Corpora elytra stops. In the absence of the juvenile hormone, pupal and later adult cuticle will be formed in holometabolous or adult in hemimetabolous insects. The hemolymph titer of egg disteroid is more critical than the titer of juvenile hormone. The egg disteroid response depends upon a certain physiological dose of the steroid. However, the juvenile hormone does not necessarily respond to dose as long as the juvenile hormone amount is above a certain critical level. So, there is a threshold level of juvenile hormone. Above this level, cells will respond. Below that level, they will not respond. Also, there is discrete JH sensitive periods, that is, if juvenile hormone is present above a threshold level, then a current developmental state is maintained. If juvenile hormone is below the threshold level, then there is a switch in developmental pathways. The juvenile hormone sensitive periods are the periods during which juvenile hormone is exerting its influence. Outside of these periods, cells are relatively unresponsive to juvenile hormone. In hemimetabolous insects, there are juvenile hormone sensitive periods prior to each molt. If juvenile hormone is present, then the commitment is for another larval cuticle at the next molt. If juvenile hormone is absent, then there is transformation that occurs to develop adult characteristics at the next molt. It is thought that egg disteroids are controlling the actual differentiation into the adult stage. In holometabolous insects, there are juvenile hormone sensitive periods prior to each larval to larval molt. If juvenile hormone is present, then another larva will be produced at the next molt. The last instar is more complicated due to the pupal stage. If juvenile hormone is absent during the first juvenile hormone sensitive period, then the next molt will be a pupal molt. If juvenile hormone is present during the second juvenile hormone sensitive period, then the next molt will be a pupal molt. So, the last instar has two periods, one where juvenile hormone is absent and one where juvenile hormone is present. Summary: ecdysis comes from the Greek word ekudesis, which means put off. It is defined as the shedding of an outer integument of or layer of skin, as by insects, crustaceans and snakes. It is also called molting. It is commonly considered that ecdysis is necessary because the exoskeleton is rigid and cannot grow like skin. However, it also helps in the repair and regeneration of many organs. The process begins when epidermal cells start to divide, increasing in number, become closely packed and columnar in form. The next step is apolysis, where the old cuticle breaks away from the epidermal cells, forming a subcuticular space beneath the old cuticle. enzymes are secreted into the space below the cuticle. The epidermal cells begin to secrete the new cuticle. The insect breaks out of the old cuticle along a median line. Then the insect wriggles and squirms free from the old skin. Then the exocuticle becomes hard due to quinone tanning and sclerotization. Each stage of development between the molds for insect in the endopterygota is called an instar or stadium, and that of exopterygota is called a nymph. There may be up to 15 nymphal stages. Endopterygota generally has only 4 or 5 instars. When an immature insect has grown sufficiently to require a larger exoskeleton, sensory input from the body activates certain neurosecretory cells in the brain. These neurons respond by secreting brain hormone, which trigger the corpora cardiaca to release their store of prothoracic cotropic hormone into the circulatory system. This sudden pulse of the PTTH stimulates the prothoracic glands to secrete molting hormone or egg disteroids. A rising concentration of egg disteroids stimulates other neurosecretory cells in the ventral ganglia to secrete bursicon, a hormone that causes hardening and darkening of the integument or tanning due to the formation of quinone cross linkages in the exocuticle, also called sclerotization. In immature insects, juvenile hormone is secreted by the corpora alata prior to each molt.